Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Alhamdulillah wa salatu wa salam ala rasulillah. Dear friends, we have seen the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in his 23 years of inviting people to Islam. He has been all along talking to them with respect, with kindness, gentleness, concern for their well-being in this life and in the life after. We know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told him that it is of God's grace that you have been soft and kind. فَبِمَا رَحْمَةٍ مِّن رَبِّكَ فَبِمَا رَحْمَةٍ مِّنَ اللَّهِ لِنْتَ لَهُمْ وَلَوْ كُنْتَ فَظًّا غَلِيظَ الْقَلْبِ لَنْفَضُّوا مِّنْ حَوْلِكَ. In the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands us to be kind and gentle across the board. وَقُولُوا لِلنَّاسِ حُسْنًا. Always talk to others with kindness and gentleness. That helps a lot to get the message across. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam advised us, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ الرِّفْقَ فِي الْأَمْرِ كُلِّهِ. God loves kindness in everything you do in life. However, the response of Quraysh was quite the opposite. Started with tabbat yadak or tabban laka ali hadha jama'atana, the response of his uncle Abu Lahab. They opposed him, they ridiculed him, they harassed his followers, abused the weak and the women and the servants, and tortured many of them, and committed murder by killing several of them. And we mentioned last week the first martyr in Islam, a servant with the name of Sumayya. That verbal abuse and physical abuse escalated and ended with plots to kill the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to finish him, to liquidate him. And we know that was the main reason he made the hijrah to Medina. There he continued to the peaceful approach, but Quraysh imposed on him with Arabia and the rest of the powers who did not like the message, imposed on him their way of resolving crises and problems, and that is war. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who was merciful and has a gentle heart, he went down to their level of resolving conflicts, and he taught them a lesson, and in 5 years he turned his enemies to his friends, and he continued the rest of his life with message of love and peace till he died. We mentioned last week those who were, probably everyone was tortured, but those are the most, and it happened for them to be the weakest in society. We mentioned Bilal ibn Rabah and his mother Hamama. We mentioned the torture of Khabbab ibn al-Arat. We mentioned the torture of Ammar ibn Yasir and his mother, Sumayya, who was killed by Abu Jahl. Also his father, Yasir ibn Amir al-Ansi, Khalif Bani Makhzum, he was tortured by Abu Jahl. And the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would pass by and tell them, patience, patience, ala Yasir, fa inna maw'idakum al-jannah. Be patient, your abode, your final residence will be in heaven. Quraysh realized after the first migration to Habasha, the second migration to Habasha, and we mentioned last week how they dispatched Amr ibn al-As to get them back, but his mission failed. And the Muslim enjoyed peace and security in the kingdom of the righteous, Christian king or Negus and Najashi. They lived there over 10 years till the seventh year of the Hijrah, where they came back to Medina. And there were 70 plus of the Muslims, more than half of the Muslims. You know, in the 13 years of Dawah in Medina, in Mecca, only close to 200 people became Muslims. And those annoyed Quraysh big time. So Quraysh realized that this tactics of harassment, abuse, torture, killing is not gonna work, because the followers of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam been increasing every day. So they went to another tactic of temptation and enticement. In one of their meeting in Dar al-Nadwa, Utbah ibn Rabi'ah ibn Abd Shams ibn Abd Manaf, one of the prominent figures of Quraysh, he told his friends and the chiefs and the leaders that, leave it up to me. I am going to go to Muhammad and talk to him. So Utbah ibn Rabi'ah went and met the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he talked to him very nicely. And he addressed him as my nephew. Being older, he's like his uncle. They are cousins, far cousins, or second cousins. He told them, oh, my nephew, you know your position, your situation, your prestige among us. You know, he lived 40 years. They loved him. They knew he's the best. He is, has the best heritage, the best in everything. So he told them, you know how much we loved you and we respected you. But you brought this Islam. You brought this oneness of God. You brought what you brought of Quran. And with this, we see the family's been broken, and we see your followers been ridiculing those who worship the idols. And listen to me, O Muhammad, I have an offer for you to make. What is that offer? He told them, if you brought this business of Islam for a monetary reward, that means for worldly material gain, we would collect money and give it to you so you would be the richest man in Arabia. And if you brought this Islam to become the best among us and to become the king, we are ready to make you our king. And we would not pass any law, any treaty, any judgment without your signature. And if what is happening to you of this revelation and so on, it is something of possession with spirits or things outside your hand, we will get you the best doctors in the world to cure you. And in another narration of Tabari, he offered him to give you the most beautiful women in Arabia in marriage so you can marry them. And when he finished, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, with all politeness, we know it about him, he addressed him by his nickname Abu al-Walid. That's out of respect. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is very respectful. So he told him, "Did you finish Abu al-Walid?" He said, "Yes." Then Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam recited unto him Hamim Tanzilul Kitabi min ar-Rahman ar-Rahim to almost half of the surah. And at that time, Utba ibn Rabi'a was shivering out of feeling the Quran and its effect on the soul and in the body, and he begged him to stop here. And he told him, "I have not brought what I brought to ask for your money, nor to ask the most respected, the most honorable among you, nor I'm asking to be the king of Arabia, but Almighty God has sent me as a messenger, and he revealed unto me a book, and he ordered me to be the bringer of glad tidings and a warner of the punishment in the hereafter. And I have delivered the message, and I have advised you. If you accept what I brought, that's your share in this life and the hereafter. And if you reject what I have brought, I will be patient, I will be steadfast, I will be perseverant till God judge. Be the judge between me and you." They did not give up. They amassed a delegation of the elders of Quraysh, and they went to the house of Abu Talib. And they told Abu Talib, "This is a matter very serious, and we have an offer to make. We will give you the best man of Bani Makhzum." And I told you how Bani Makhzum, they were very prestigious, very good looking, very. So they brought the brother of Khalid ibn al-Walid, Umara ibn al-Walid. And he told Abu Talib, "We will give you this handsome young man. Make it your son and give us Muhammad. So we'll take him and kill him." So Abu Talib told him, what a deal. You give me your son to raise him up and feed him and protect him and take care of him, and I give you my own son. He's the son of his brother. So you take him and kill him? This is not fair. So he rejected that silly proposal. But they wanted to talk to Muhammad in his presence, and Abu Talib summoned Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And when he came to the room, Abu Jahl, he had set up the situation to intimidate Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He did not leave any space in the back of the room where the biggest of Quraysh sitting, and he closed all the gap. So the only place available in that room was at the doorstep. So Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam came and found no place to sit except at the doorstep. But Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was humble. His importance does not come from a chair or from location in the room. His importance is within. Wherever he sits, he becomes the center of the universe. And he was humble down to earth, and he didn't mind sit at the doorstep. And here Abu Talib told Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam the offer of Quraysh, again, to give him all the wealth, to give him all the power, to give him all the women in marriage and relinquish this issue of La ilaha illallah and keep business as usual. The 360 idols and all the corruption and all the abuses and all of the killing and the strong take advantage of the weak and everything to keep it as is. But Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, who felt the feeling of Abu Talib. Abu Talib now is in his 80s, very weak, very frail. He's been taking care of him for years and years and years. And he's under tremendous pressure from Quraysh to lift his support to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, which is based on the tribal system and the honor code that anyone touches Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he's touching Bani Hashim in all its entirety. Even many of them were not believers in Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And here the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam uttered word, we need to write it with golden ink and frame it and put it in our bedroom. He said with strong words, which I'm sure shook the foundation of Abu Jahl and all those great chieftains of Quraysh. He addressed his uncle and he told him, Ya Am, O uncle, Wallahi, I swear by God, if they put the sun in my right hand and the moon in my left hand, so I would leave this message, I will not, till Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes me prevail or perish in that cause. And that was the last word for all these efforts of Quraysh, of temptation, trying to persuade Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam to leave this message of La ilaha illallah. Then Quraysh met again and thought about it. And Abu Jahl was the spearhead of the opposition. Of course, he has many lieutenants. He has Uqba ibn Abi Mu'ayth. He had Al-Hakam ibn Abi Al-As. He had Al-As ibn Wa'il al-Sahmi. He was many of those 7, 8, 10 of the great leaders of Quraysh who opposes Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And they met together and planned a social boycott and pact of injustice and aggression. So what did they agree? They said, all Bani Hashim, Muslims or non-Muslims, and all Bani al-Muttalib, they are, Muttalib is the brother of Hashim, and they are from the same family, and they receive the same treatment. We will oblige them to go to the mountains. We will blockade them. We will boycott them. We will prevent anyone of Quraysh to talk to them, to intermingle with them, to marry from their girls, to marry their boys, and prevent any business transaction. No buying, no selling. And they wrote this in a document and they signed it. And the man whose name Mansur ibn Ikrim al-Abdari, he was the one who wrote that document. And the stories or the Seerah tells us that immediately after he finished, he had a stroke and his right arm was paralyzed. And they hang that document where? Inside the Kaaba. Inside the Kaaba. As the most sacred place. So, and they executed that boycott. And we know the Muslims been pushed to Sha'ib Abi Talib. And we know men, women, children, for 3 long years been boycotted, been blockaded, been prevented from buying, selling, from prevented from getting water and food, and the Muslims suffered a lot. Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas tells us how he was so hungry at night, and he tried to touch anything, found like dry leaves of trees. Even he found some soft skin, he doesn't know what it is, and he ate it. And the same thing, Utba ibn Ghazwan, he tell us horrible stories about the suffering they met in the Sha'b Abi Talib. By the way, Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas is the one who built Al-Kufa, and Utba ibn Ghazwan, he was the one who built Al-Basra. Those are the qualities of the Muslims. When they became free and liberated, they made miracles. So who was the hero of the boycott? It was an old woman. She was 62 years of age when the blockade started, and she was 65 when the blockade ended. She used all her wealth to channel through her relatives from Bani Asad and different tribe to buy food and smuggle the food to Bani Hashim. She wasn't from Bani Hashim even. The blockade does not include her. And you guessed who is that woman. Anyone can tell me? Very good. Mashallah, okay. We have smart kids here, smart young men. Yes, Khadija bint Khuwaylid radiallahu anha was the hero or the heroine of the blockade. She spent all her wealth to feed the poor, the needy, the children, and to support the Muslims in Sha'b Abi Talib. She was almost 65. And you know, when she died immediately after that blockade was lifted. She suffered a lot. And we know that Khadija bint Khuwaylid was given the glad tiding to be in heaven by the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So at the end of the blockade, we know that few good-hearted people from Quraysh, though they are non-believers, but they were quality of men. They know the human rights. They know the divine rights. You cannot abuse human beings. You cannot torture them. You cannot starve them. You do not have him die from thirst. These are divine rights. Doesn't matter how tyrant you are or how powerful you are. There's a line you cannot cross. Otherwise, you are committing crimes against humanity. You hear that term a lot on TV. Because you cannot, even if you are a soldier and your superior ordering you to commit crime against humanity, you can refuse. Because you cannot override the divine laws by the human laws. That excuse did not work with the soldiers of Hitler and lieutenant of Hitler. At the north, they were brought to justice. They said, well, I'm an employee. I had to obey my superior. That doesn't work. لا طاعة لمخلوق في معصية الخالق. You cannot abuse anyone, which is God told us not to abuse, because human beings are dignified by the decree from God. وَلَقَدْ كَرَّمْنَا بَنِي آدَمَ. You cannot humiliate or insult or hurt any human being, even if your superior tells you to do so. So we know those good-hearted people, Hisham ibn Amr al-Amiri. He went to Abu al-Bakhtir ibn Hisham and al-Mut'im ibn Adi and Zuhair ibn Umayyah and Zum'a ibn al-Aswad. And they were non-believers. They were pagan. They were idol worshippers. But they were good people. And this is another lesson we need to know. In humanity, There's people who are followers of other religions, like Jews and Christian and Hindu or Buddhist or regardless, we have tens of religions on earth. Beyond religion, they are human beings. And many of them are good as you are. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us, "An-nasu ma'adin, khiyaruhum fil jahiliyyah, khiyaruhum fil Islam, idha faqihu." So there's good people everywhere. Gandhi is a good person. Martin Luther King is a good person. Nelson Mandela is a good person. They defended humanity and the right of human beings. It doesn't matter if they are believer in this or that, that's God's design. He created many religions, or at least he sent one message, but people interpret it in different ways, and that's why we have all kinds of religions. So those great five people met, and Hisham ibn Amr started the talk in the gathering of Dar-Un-Nadwa where Abu Jahl was there. And Abu Jahl was responsible for most of those atrocities. And he said, is it fair for us to eat and drink and get dressed and buy and sell and get married? And our fellow cousins left in this miserable situation in the mountains? And then they set up themselves in different corners of Dar-Un-Nadwa. Hisham ibn Amr got the support of Abu al-Bukhtar ibn Hisham and al-Mut'im ibn Adi and Zuhair. All of them went together and said, we are going to burn that document in the Kaaba and stop this nonsense. Abu Jahl realized that this is a conspiracy bin net at night. And they said, هَذَا أَمْرٌ قُضِيَ بِلَيْلِ. But it was a good thing, human thing, humane thing. And at that time, Abu Talib, he mentioned to them that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him that that document they wrote has been eaten up by the termite. And there's nothing left of it but the name of Allah in the beginning of the document. Quraysh used to say, Bismika Allahumma. So when Abu Talib challenged Quraysh to go and check the document, if Muhammad is telling the truth, so they went to the Kaaba, they opened the door, they went inside, they looked at that document, they found the whole parchment been eaten up by termite, except the name of God. Bismika Allahumma. And by this, Quraysh lifted the blockade from the Muslim against the Muslims, and they let him go back to their homes and buy and sell and live normal life. Ironically, when Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, after like 10 years, came back to Mecca victorious, he erected his tent in the same spot when Abu Jahl and the rest of the pagans conspired to boycott Muslims and send them to the mountains. And he told his followers, or he told Jabir ibn Abdullah, one of the companions, in this spot Quraysh met and vowed to boycott the Muslims and send them to the mountain. And he erected his tent in the same spot as a victorious conqueror of Mecca. The boycott finished in the year 10, and two things happened. We will talk about them, inshallah, next session. Two sad things happened. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam lost his wife, Khadija. She died after the boycott. The effort she made took its toll on her. She was 65 years of age, and she was so energetic, going up the mountain, coming down the mountain. It drained all her energy, and she became sick, and she died. Also, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam protector according to the tribal laws of Arabia, protector of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Abu Talib. He died very shortly after, and it was a big sadness in the life of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Even he called the year of the sorrow, the year of the sorrow, عام الحزن. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله العظيم لي ولكم والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.